Let's see. Left, right, left, right. This is Sean. What's going on? What's going on in my chair? I'm going to talk about some computer stuff. A long time ago, I had one of these things, a Color Computer 3 made by Tandy, Radio Shack. And it ran OS 9 level 2, and it had a thing called G Shell. And I've been spending an hour trying to find a picture of G Shell on the internet, and there's not one single picture of G Shell. Why? Probably because G Shell was from 9 for G Shell was from 87. I don't think there wasn't much internet in 87. So this is the closest picture I could find. Looks kind of like G Shell. This is on a different computer. I think this is Atari stuff. This was before Windows 3.1. The Macintosh had already been out for like 4 years. And other systems were doing this kind of a GUI. The next, Steve Jobs' next step was out for his next computer. And it had the, there's a name for this GUI, I can't remember. It's only been 35 years. I can't remember that far back. I liked back in 92, I was making a GUI for the Color Computer 3 as a hobby. I was in between jobs, and at the time, Yanni was at the Acropolis. What was that place called? He did a live concert in Greece at Athens, I think, at the Acropolis. That was back in 93-ish, 92-ish. So around that time, I was working on a graphical user interface for the Color Computer 3. I wanted it to look like this, but I didn't really. I was not a fan of the arrow keys being together like this on a scroll bar. But I like the color and the shading of the buttons, the raised up buttons and the oh, there were some other things it had. I like the little X thing here. I don't know if I ever had the X's finished. The interface I was working on was from the ground up. I also got to take a look at Solaris. The SunSpark stations were running the Solaris OS. And I kind of liked how it had it. It did the things. I don't know if I liked the min max buttons or the this thing. Now nowadays this would be what? The Big Mac, the triple layer hamburger kind of thing. I don't know if I liked this back then or not. I can't remember. There were some aspects of this interface that I liked. I liked that the arrow buttons top and bottom for the scroll bar. But it too had some issues. It's like, okay, come on, what's going on here? It's like these were skins, by the way. You could there was like 8 or 9 different skins you could overlay on your GUI if it changed the whole style of the GUI and everything. But then I go back to the next, and the next had the little close button here too, and they put their little maximize minimize button here. So I don't know. I was going on, I would draw the stuff on paper, see if I liked it or not. Go to what is it? I belong to a OS9 user group club in Ocean Beach. Every third Saturday of the month, I think it was. So I'd go to that, and I'd show off some of my progress with the interface. And it looked better than this, kind of. I don't know. I don't think I did a full-blown shell using my GUI. I was using my GUI to do games, mostly video games. The interfaces for video games. And we got here. So this is what my computer looked like back in the day. This picture was taken probably around 92. I had a dust cover for the computer and a dust cover for my disk drives. Everything was stock, Radio Shack. You know, if I didn't buy, I tried not to buy third-party stuff. I always bought from Radio Shack. Had my Radio Shack conference box here. That was always nice to have. Didn't have to use the phone, just talked on the speaker like Charlie's Angels. This was the multi-pack. I was trying to remember the name of this last night, but it's called the multi-pack. And that would plug into this thing, which is basically an expansion interface board that had four slots in it. So you stick these cartridges in the slots. This one here in the front, I want to say this was the RS-232 interface for the modem. I had either a 1200 baud or a 2400 baud modem at the time. Practical peripherals, and then I had a robotics, US robotics one after a while. This cartridge here would plug into the back of the disk drives. In the old days, you know, in the Apple II Plus days, this would be one disk drive, storing up to, 56K on the thing. But halfway through the 80s, something called the half height, instead of a full height, 5 1/4 drive, you had a half height 5 1/4 drive. So I fit two of those in this case. So there's a drive A and a drive B, and they were single-sided, not double-sided drives. But I want to say almost 80K of storage on each drive. I mean, 80K was a lot back then. I mean, the programs I wrote were only, 8K. So hardly, I take that back. Most of the programs I wrote were like 2K. So you could fit a lot on a drive. Back then, a floppy disk was about $8 for one disk. That was crazy. Later on, you get I think at Fry's Electronics, you can buy a box of 10 floppies for like $10, something like that. And then eventually I would get a job working at Byte and Floppy Computers in Claremont, or Kearney Mesa, I guess it's called. And they were selling 3-inch floppy disk drives for like a dollar each or maybe 50 cents each. I can't remember. Get a pack of 50 of them. Some of the disks would work, some of them wouldn't. You just threw away the ones that didn't work. They were not verified disks. But they were pre-formatted, though. I remember that. You could buy them formatted or unformatted. And when you format a floppy disk, it might take, 2 minutes to format the disk. So to save time, people would buy their disks pre-formatted for either Macintosh or for the Windows. The PC clones. What else we got here? Oh, this clock here. I still have the clock. It's the circuits they've long burned out. still ticks. No, I'm joking. It's the same clock you find in old dashboards on cars made from 94 to 98. One of those, you know, refrigerator magnet clocks with the two buttons to set the time and date. And this was what? This is the 10th anniversary clock. I got this. I was a subscriber to Creative Computing for 10 years. And then guess what? The magazine went under. That was the end of that. I have the last issue of Byte Magazine, which is weird. I don't know why. Maybe I'm in it. Usually, I tried to keep magazines that I was in. Especially later, 97 and afterwards, I would be posting 3D art in different computer 3D magazines and stuff. Anyway, something happened and all of this went bye-bye. I still have the TV stand. Actually, this is a printer stand. It's right here, and my printer's on top of it. And then I still have this white thing is a monitor stand from Radio Shack. I still have that. My TV's on it. And then I still have this table. I bought this table at Best back in 83. I used to have a smaller desk, which was technically a printer stand. I was using that as my desk for my Sinclair ZX81, which I still have. I still have the ZX81 in marvelous condition. But yeah, I still sit at this table here, and I still have this chair from IKEA. $12 folding chair. Still most comfortable chair I ever bought in my life, I think. Otherwise, I wouldn't be sitting in it still, right? The only problem, though, it doesn't have wheels. The chair does not have wheels on it. So this is me today. It took me a while to find this photo. This is the only thing I have that's proof. This is just a picture. I'm not in the picture, so technically this isn't proof that this is. But I do have the photo. It's in my hand. Got the shaky hand holding it in front of my camera today. There's my genie bottle. So it's my location with the photo. Now, something had happened. I won't say what. Not in this video. But I threw away all this stuff. Something new had happened, something amazing, revolutionary had happened. And I'm like, you know, it's time I gave up the Coco 3. I've done everything I could do with it. It was neat while I had it for, you know, 10 or 12 years. I was doing this kind of stuff. Running OS 9. OS 9 is basically Unix for 8-bit computers. The neatest OS 9 was the neatest thing ever. At our user groups, every time we'd go to the user group meeting, we would all say, we would cuss and groan about Windows 3.1 and how popular it was. How come OS 9 isn't popular like Windows 3.1 is? You know, those kinds of things. You know, how do we get the world to know more about OS 9? Things happened. I think Apple eventually had their OS 9, and it was a marketing branding kind of a thing, a confusion. It would confuse too many people if you're calling your product OS 9. Because Apple went from System 6, System 7, System 8, or was it OS 8? Eventually, they went from calling their thing System to OS. You know, the PowerPCs were a thing. The Apple GSs were going by the wayside. They were getting ready for the iMacs to show up. I want to say the iMacs were running OS 9. And it was a conflict of interest. You know, Microware was selling OS 9. The Macintosh came with OS 9, but it was with a slash instead of with a hyphen. It was that's kind of a big deal. It's a whole different name brand thing. It don't matter. OS 9. If you say you don't say OS dash 9 or OS slash 9 or forward slash. No one says OS forward slash 9. They say OS 9. Now they say OS X. Now they say Mac OS. I guess Apple has decided to just keep their system 10 as OS X forever. So it's going to be 10.1.2.3.11.15.20.10.99. That's when they'll run out of 10s, I guess. And they, you know, they do the thing, you know. Their operating systems are named after either places or butthead astronomers, that kind of thing. I want to say Ventura is their latest OS for the Apple, for Macintosh. And every time they come out with every two editions of their OS for the Mac, it breaks the apps. So you have to rebuy apps. Because Macintosh, you know, the Apple people keep changing their operating system and the App Store language, software's format, platforms to write for. They keep changing all that stuff. So I'm still on my current PC, 64-bit, Windows 10, whatever. I'm still running programs I wrote 30 years ago, you know, in DOS. Just works. This post-it. This was kind of important. I don't remember what I had written on there, but it was kind of a big deal. It was kind of like really, really important. And I don't know why I just kind of left it on the table there. This was in an apartment, and I don't remember. I don't remember where this was. Because I can't tell if this was taken in 91 or if this was taken in 87. Those are the only times I was taking pictures, I think. I don't have very many pictures. And I got the Radio Shack RGB monitor. It's turned off. This computer's turned off, so there's nothing going on here. If I could enhance this, maybe I could see reflections of what, you know, who else was in the room with me, that kind of thing. And then see who's taking a shower in the bathroom. And not fish, snake scale. I was trying to get the camera to focus, but the picture's not exactly in focus to begin with. And then, you know, artifacting from YouTube, I uploaded this video to YouTube so I could play it and re-record it again. So there's artifacting, blurriness introduced every time I re-record over. Okay, so here we go. So this is the... I don't remember if I call this GUI B or GUI B. The B means basic, because I wrote the GUI in basic. In basic 09, which came with OS 9 level 2, that was my favorite language of all time. Of all time, basic 09. You can go to the wiki page and look up basic 09. You can find the language there. Probably has not aged well, I'm guessing, after 30 years. But 30 years ago, it was the best version of BASIC out there. And it was for the Color Computer 3. The best of both worlds back in the 80s. Okay, so what does this say? Welcome to the latest edition of GUI B. A graphic user interface for BASIC 09. See, there's BASIC 09 right here. Copyright from me. I wrote this. I want to say summer of 92. I was writing the GUI the same time I was writing my text adventure games. and solitaire games and chess games and a Risk game and some other games. The online versions of those games didn't use the interface, but the at home, the play at home versions all had the GUI. And then Brother Jeremy, he was my pen pal. I want to say he lived near Minnesota. He was one of those guys. He lived near Canada, I think. He got in contact with me. He wanted to be a beta tester for GUI B. And I sent him some code. Or maybe he typed it in. Maybe I mailed him a listing of it. It was just a basic program. Maybe he typed it in on his computer to try it out. I can't remember. It was like 35 years ago. And he was a huge color computer fanatic like I was. And I also sent him other stuff. I was making a newsletter. I want to say it was called the OS9 Programmer's Journal. And I emailed my brother to see if I ever gave him any of those. I don't think he was using a color computer when I was making the newsletter, but he says he'll look and see if he happens to have anything. Any newsletters I printed out and stapled together and mailed out to people. He doesn't remember. I don't remember. I would like to have a copy of one of those and just show it off. Maybe I have it. Maybe in one of my moving boxes from 40 years ago. It might still be in one of those boxes. I have moving boxes I've never unpacked, never opened. Maybe that'll be an unboxing video one day. Opening up boxes that I haven't looked at since 89. So I don't remember putting this GUI 3.0 here. Maybe Brother Jeremy added this in. Because this is a demo. I had a little demo showing how the buttons worked in the GUI. Here's the continue button. So you click on it. Takes you to the next screen. GUI B can create different types of windows. The types available are raised, dropped, etched, carved, framed, pick frame, shadowed. Now, pick frame, I don't remember if I had a... Because see, Brother Jeremy probably added more stuff to the GUI than I did. And then while he was doing his version of the GUI B, I was still developing GUI B at home on my computer. So we could have ended up with two different versions of GUI B. You know, there was no GitHub back then. So we weren't like pushing and pulling, merging. We weren't doing those kinds of things. There was, what do they call it? In a way, this was open source shareware. I guess back then we called it shareware. Your software was either vaporware or shareware or freeware. And I think I was doing freeware. That may have been the license I used back then. I wasn't trying to make money on this. I was selling my games. Some of my games I was selling for 15 bucks a pop, especially the text adventure. And that used the GUI B. But there's something else. There's FX09. I want to say there was another module I wrote called FX09. And GUI B would make calls to FX09. And FX09 had the box drawing commands to do these things. It's all coming back to me now. Oh, what did that say? Hang on. Okay, GUI B. Oh, by the way, the speed that this prints and everything, that's how fast the thing ran on the Cocoa 3. The Cocoa 3 was only... It was only 2 megahertz. Is that the right word? Not kilohertz, but megahertz. I think 2 kilohertz would be kind of slow. Yeah, the Cocoa 3 that I had ran at 2 megahertz. Now, the 386s that would come out around that time, they were running at 10 megahertz. Some of them were running at 25 megahertz. This was running at 2 megahertz. So GUI-B also allows the user to divide the screen with horizontal and vertical etched lines. Oh, okay. Did we have those? Were there any etched? Oh yeah, here's a horizontal etched line. There ain't any in here. Don't see one. This one had dotted lines. I don't know. I think I had a enable disable, so it would gray out the text like this. I think I had that in later versions of GUI B. So you couldn't click on those options. Okay, so here's a vertical and here's a horizontal. Yay, just little separators. So raised button, etched, framed. Some of these you could click on. Normally the framed would be this frame would take up the whole screen, and inside the frame would be you are entering a dungeon. You see nothing. It's pitch black. What do you do? That kind of nonsense would show up in a framed window. And then here's the reverse. This one's shadowed. It's got more shadow. I thought we'll call it a shadowed window. It's got more shadow, like the button's just raised up higher than this one. You got a dropped window. So these two are opposites. These are the opposites of these. If that makes sense. The inverse, these are the inverse ones of this. Man, I don't, oh, and then you also, it also did a fill of some kind, or I think. So this would be like the menu bar or the title bar or the window bar, whatever you want to call this. That would be a thing. The default colors were white, black, gray and dark gray. You had four shades of gray, I think, with the Color Computer 3, which was fine. I mean, it worked great. It worked great for the Next interface had that too, pretty much, except it had color. Gosh. Depending on the mode you're in on a color computer, I think your color choices were either 16 or 32. So GUIB can also create various types of squares. Okay, so these are squares. These aren't the other whatever the other things were. These are different. So we got a pop square, a push square. So you get frames around. This would be a frame, I guess. And then anyway, continue. I want to click on continue. I don't. The reason why there's two mice here. The big fat mouse is the one the Coco 3 uses. And then this looks like a Windows mouse. So I'm guessing this software is running on a Windows computer emulating a Coco 3. So the Coco mouse is kind of following the Windows mouse, which looks kind of weird because I don't remember two mouse cursors when I was using the Coco 3. So was one of my favorites is the gadgets routine. Okay. Now I don't remember the bullet looking like this. I thought mine were more round. I'm sure mine were round. This is oval shape. The diamond, I remember doing the diamond and it was hard as heck. Trying to get a diamond to look right. Because depending on the number, 80 column screen or a 40 column screen, the screen gets scrunched, so the aspect ratios get scrunched on these things. So I was trying to, I want to say mine was GUI 4.0, GUI B4.0. Because I was back in 94, in 94, 95, I was still writing, you know, updating this thing. Let's see, Sean Driscoll, that's me, designed a set of routines which allows the programmer to use vertical and horizontal scroll bars. Okay. If you say so. So here we have a black background, and then we've got some windows here. So we've seen this one before. We've seen that one before. Okay, so here's a horizontal scroll bar. Is there a thing that goes in here? Maybe there's a thing. Oh, there it is. There's the thing. So you click on these buttons, and then this thing would move around. You know, the scroll bars. They were kind of new to a lot of people that were buying computers for the first time. What's this do? I don't know. Click on it. Normally, you open up a file, and it has a scrolled list of file names that you can open for your, when they would advertise these computers as being in your kitchen counter and you're doing your kitchen recipes and you had to look up a recipe for bacon and eggs. You'd scroll through what file that would be in, open it up, and it would tell you what food you had to buy and how much food you had to measure and count and put in cups and spoons. I don't cook, so I just assume that's what the apps would say. Okay, it can run in either a 320 by 192 screen. Okay, this is a 16 color screen. Type 6 or type 8 screen, or a 640 by 192 type 7 screen, and the 640 by 192, I think, was 8 color. I would think. That would be horrific if it was 4 color. But this is 30 years ago. No, 35 years ago. This is the 640 by 192 resolution screen. Yeah, I think I did something with this box or this diamond so it didn't look so crooked. And I want to say I made this a circle. Because this doesn't look very good. This one doesn't look very good. This could be an old, it's called a gadget, I guess. Button gadget. I want to say, yeah, this is an old version of GUIB. Anyway, so just watching this video, I'm starting to remember some stuff. Like I don't own anything from Color Computer 3. So if you see this video and you're like, oh, you know, give me your stuff. If you're not using it, give it to me. Or, you know, I don't have it anymore. I got rid of it. I got rid of it like 28 years ago. Maybe I'll explain in a video why I did that. What did they say about this? Oh. What I would like to see, though, those of you that find this video and know more about this than I do, who still use this kind of stuff, I want to see a YouTube video of someone playing either Shanghai or Stranded and Out of Gas. I would love to see someone on YouTube who has a Color Computer 3 running those games. That would be so awesome. And then I can do a commentary about the game while I'm watching you guys play the thing. I can explain how I wrote the code and all that stuff. Because I don't know if the source code was out there for those things. I can't remember. And let me know in the comments if you have this. Let me know in the comments if there's a module called FX09 that you have to make GUI B run. Because I want to say there was two programs you needed to even do this kind of thing. Anyway, talk to you later.